you. Thanks for having me. And thanks, Dave. It's, again, funny that we have to come all the way to New Mexico to hang out again for after 10 years. It's like an anniversary or something. I chatted with Dave a few weeks ago. We talked a little bit about, okay, like what kinds of things would folks be interested in here? And so what I'm going to talk about, this talk has had a few different titles depending on where you're looking, but broadly interdisciplinary frameworks. And a lot of these are inspired from my work in quantitative biology education at the intersection of those things, but I think can be applied more broadly. And so I'd be interested also in see what you feel like, how these fit in the multiple sectors in which you work as well. So I'm going to talk about one which emerged out of the NIMBIOS working group, and then a second which emerged out of my own background in complex adaptive systems and coevolutionary networks. Okay, so Dave mentioned that I have my degrees in mathematics. They're all interdisciplinary, so unlike a lot of many of us mathematicians, my undergraduate degree was in interdisciplinary mathematics, or my master's was. My undergraduate had a minor in zoology. My graduate education was in mathematical ecology and evolutionary theory. So I actually am sort of more half-half, I guess you could say, with biology and mathematics, or theoretical biology. And so my research has spanned, initially I was in computational neurobiology, then when I was at Tennessee I was looking at coevolution of ecological networks. When I moved to Unity, I did primarily wildlife disease ecology for student research, and then I've been moving more into environmental data science and social network analysis. But in particular, my emphasis has been in applying these systems and theories and frameworks to interdisciplinary quantitative education. And so what does interdisciplinarity mean? For me, this means a way to live in both the biology research world as well as the mathematics teaching world. And so it's a little bit of identity affirmation in the multiple worlds that I live in, and now I'm sort of adding computer science to this as well formally. It's also my way of contributing to a broader solving of wicked problems in environmental science, but also more broadly in education. And then lastly, it's sort of survival in a liberal arts environment. So when I first got to Unity, I was the only mathematics PhD in the entire college. So what does that mean for my collaborative opportunities? It's like you have to be forced to work and talk across interdisciplinary boundaries, and I actually enjoy that a lot. So sort of beyond interdisciplinarity, I think of some of the other words that I've been introduced to lately, which are netweaver. That's how I describe some of my work in collective action. Boundary spanner and synthesis. I love connecting ideas and people across disciplines. So I put this up here just because, again, most of my time at Unity College, I was there for 8 years. It was an environmental school. And what I was trying to do was create and revised discipline for environmental and biology majors that was quantitative and was gonna serve them. And so I was really influenced by the vision and change document that came out roughly about the same time I started there. And in particular, these core competencies and disciplinary practices, which I feel also very strongly align with even SFI. So we have ability to apply the process of science, quantitative reasoning, modeling and simulation, tap into the interdisciplinary nature of science, communicate and collaborate with other disciplines, and understand the relationship between science and society. So I think these are just perfect, emblematic, wonderful goals that we're all working towards. Dave mentioned my affiliation with CUBES. CUBES was founded as a way to bring across all of the work that was being done in biology education, math education, and beyond to synthesize those practices together and help us better prepare to do that work with our students. There's wonderful educational practices that are grounded in the biology world that are not getting translated into the mathematics classrooms that are preparing those biology students and vice versa. And so CUBES itself is a virtual education center. So we do not live at one institution in one physical location the way SFI does. We do not have one central place. What we do is we live on the website. We live in this virtual infrastructure. I work across, we have five institutions that form the leadership team for CUBES. We're funded primarily by NSF, IUS, which is out of the education, and they had a call for called Ideas Lab. So we have about $3.8 million in funding for CUBES. As part of this, creating this virtual infrastructure, so we do things with, like we have cloud-based simulation software, we have collaborative working spaces, but we also run peer faculty mentoring networks. So they're an opportunity where faculty from across the nation, even the world, can sign up and think about how to incorporate a particular kind of really vetted curricula into their classroom and sort of work in this collaborative peer support experience throughout an entire semester as that curriculum is getting adapted. As part of this, we were trying to think about what kinds of practices, best practices, need to be part of our faculty mentoring networks. And we had identified in particular that there seemed to be a lack of synthesis around modeling education, particularly interdisciplinary modeling education. And so we proposed a working group to NIMBIOS specifically to work on this problem and unpack the black box of models for the faculty that we were working with, and so that they could use that with their students. So here's one of the pictures NIMBIOS has you take outside when you do a working group there. And I just point this out because the team, super interdisciplinary in terms of sort of the spectrum of biology to biology education research, math to math education research, and also physics education research. It was really wonderful and challenging at the same time, which I think is part of the point here. So we discussed a lot of issues. We started with, okay, what quantitative skills are needed? What tools are available? What are the barriers? And the barriers we identified are maybe math anxiety. Language came up. And we, in between these physical meetings at the working group, we also had in the in-between an online journal club that we were maintaining in the 6 months between meetings. And by the time we had really delved into, you know, after we kind of said, okay, here are all of the issues, and we said, which one are we going to tackle on as a group, we zeroed in as language as a key. And part of the reason was because as we're talking, we found we were not able to make a lot of actual forward progress because we were using language and the same language, but meaning very different things. So mathematicians, when we would say, oh yeah, so how do you teach modeling? We were thinking, how do you construct equations that represent ideas? And the biologists were like, how do you fit data to a model? And we just, there are different pedagogies or different approaches, and we just kept kind of talking across each other. And language, identifying language as a potential barrier is not a new thing. It certainly reflects other work done by interdisciplinary educators like Joe Reddish, who works in physics for biology education. So finally we sat down and we said, okay, here's the definition we're gonna use for model. Let's all agree on it, let's all use the same, this is what we mean. And in particular, we wanted it to be a definition that allowed everyone's perception of what a model was to exist. So a model is a simplified, abstract, or concrete representation of relationships and or processes in the real world constructed for some purpose. And again, the part of the key here, it's an abstraction, not a perfect representation of reality. And it can have many forms. So one of the first forms we talked about was verbal. The rate of population growth is proportional to its size. And that, right, that one sentence is a verbal model. Visual. And I think we wanted to go beyond just graphs, but also think about, for example, box and arrow type modeling. And this is a visual representation of a model. Symbolic. That would be the one probably a lot of mathematicians would come to the forefront with. Numerical. We had this great argument about, is data a model? Yes, it's a model. That's what we said. And so this also is part of our framework. And I'll pause there because these particular buckets, verbal, visual, symbolic, numerical, have been used elsewhere as a rule of four. This was part of the broad calculus reform movement. It started appearing in textbooks. Here are the ways at which we're going to look at things. It actually started as a rule of three, added to later, and it became rule of four. But that's sort of broadly applied to calculus. Through our conversations, we realized that something was missing if we started talking about models with biologists, and very quickly we realized that experiential was not something that was part of that rule of four that mathematicians have in some way already adopted, and that actually many biologists start there as a starting place. They start with observation, field observation, they create a laboratory experiment, and that's all part of an intrinsic and important key part of their processes that they engage in. And so that's where we said, okay, well, let's make this rule of five now. And so here are model representations, experiential, verbal, symbolic, visual, numerical, all abstractions of some reality. And what's nice about that is that in some way, not only does it allow for everyone's perceptions of what a model means for them to exist, but then if you go back and you pull on the blind man and the elephant parable, so each of us within each of our disciplines might be looking at the same system. And because we're using different representations, we might be seeing different things. And so in the parable, a person who is touching the tail of an elephant might think it's a rope. And so it's not a rope, it's an elephant, but they are touching the tail. So to them, it's a rope. And by expanding this out to thinking about how each of us work primarily with different representations, we can create a broader picture of what's really going on, that working together, it's not that one representation is worse than another, but rather by coming together, we realize it's an elephant and we can actually do more work through that. And it, once we came to that place, instead of talking across each other, now we were able to move forward. And then the other question comes up, well, what's the difference between model and modeling? Modeling being activity, a verb. And so the way we defined it was to either the point of their various activities, either the point of bringing reality to a model or revising a model, checking it back with reality, and any of the activities that moved between representations. So by taking something that's a verbal model and then translating it into a symbolic form, we're performing an activity that is a modeling activity. And that's not all modeling is. A lot of times people use modeling broadly as a term that encompasses an entire process, and I'm going to distinguish from that later. So I actually, when I was teaching calculus, put this up in my classroom, and I said very distinctly, it is a lot easier to help you learn how to manipulate symbolic equations than it is for you to understand what that means verbally. These are the hard things. The arrows are actually the really hard things. Moving between representation and model representations often are very, very difficult. And I think acknowledging that up front does a lot. A lot of times also what I might do is put this up there and say, well, in the calculus class, my role oftentimes is that while we might simulate some data, we don't often go from numerical to symbolic, and that's often the realm of statistics. And so this helps us sort of understand what are the roles that each of the subdisciplines even play in their broader knowledge accumulation and learning. And then we can define the modeling process as a set of boxes and arrows. You could have, you start with a classroom lab experiment observation to develop some kind of verbal hypothesis. You're moving from experiential to verbal. Then maybe you see this observation of I don't know, your petri plate bacteria growing, and that leads you to some kind of model that you move from verbal, I think it's doubling every 24 hours, to symbolic. So there's a lot of steps that you connect as part of a broader process, right? And what's nice is that set of boxes and arrows is also a disciplinary path that each discipline has, can live on here, on this framework, regardless of what discipline you're in. You can probably find yourself somewhere as a set of boxes and arrows, as a path through the framework. And it's interesting because when I've sat here or talked to large liberal arts audiences that include even art people alongside computational people, they both kind of see themselves in this, which is actually quite nice. I think even though this was developed as a way for biology and math to talk better, I think this opens us up even a little bit more broadly. And it's that inclusive approach to interdisciplinarity that I think is the value here. Part of our initial conversations reflected on earlier conversations that we'd had with colleagues in which, because we didn't acknowledge their way of modeling, we somehow were saying, I don't want to work with you, because we didn't see ourselves. We didn't know how that collaboration could go. So, and I take ownership for this. I remember very early on the job market thinking, meeting some biologists, and they were like, oh, you work in mathematical biology? Yeah, I have data. And I was like, oh, I don't really work with real data. All right. and I didn't realize that was just their way of saying they wanted to work with me. And they were trying to say, oh, here's what I do that lives in your space somewhere. I was thinking, oh, I'm a theoretician. I don't work with data. A lot has changed since then, but I think that was a mistake I made. And that can lead to these moments where we exclude people from the conversation, whether we're intending to do so or not. Okay, well, that picture didn't show up, but pretend there is a side-by-side, I want to go before and see if it hid. No. Side-by-side view of the process of science and the process of modeling as a process. And so there are actually a lot of analogies. We do a lot of the same things, except mathematicians often, instead of setting up a physical experiential representation, we set up a symbolic one, right? But oftentimes the process is very much the same. Though the process of science and even the modeling process as presented oftentimes are very linear. And what we also like about the framework is it allows for a lot of movement in between and jumping around to different representations. In fact, I argue all real science is very much more messy than the linear frameworks that we tend to present. And you can see how something like this taps in to all of these pieces of vision and change. So even though this was carved out as a moment for thinking about how to teach quantitative tools for biologists, I think it's more broad. I think that there are more disciplines that can be that can use this or adapt this. I also think that it's interesting to acknowledge the language in your own research collaborations. And I think it's important also to acknowledge this, especially as you're trying to create a more inclusive community of practitioners to work with and validate each other's expertise, disciplinary identities, and so on. This Rule of Five article appears in a recent special issue of Primus, Problems, Resources, and Issues in Mathematical Undergraduate Studies. full of acronyms. My world is full of acronyms. It was co-edited by a few of us, Victor Piercy, myself, Stella Hoffring, and Susan Ganter, as part of a broader NSF Summit P grant that was intended to, or is intended to, it's in the process of, reforming foundational mathematics courses in conjunction with partner disciplines. So really making partner disciplines an integral part to planning your quantitative experiences. And so this special issue is a two-volume special issue, goes through conversations, how they happen, methods for collaboration, results of collaboration on curriculum and broader. Okay, so I'm gonna skip to framework two. I sort of said that the second framework for interdisciplinary collaboration was inspired from my own background in coevolutionary networks. So I worked for my PhD on the coevolution of plant pollinator mutualistic networks. And since that point, I think a lot about what are the, that's sort of my framing for a lot of what I encounter. You know, everybody has a framing. Mine, you know, like many, came from what they did their PhD in. And so I look across, I was working at one point with some folks on the complex adaptive socio-ecological ecosystems. As I have moved into this sort of computational studies world, I've been thinking a lot about sort of the human technology frontier. And of course, you know, math biology could be considered coupled ecological network in some sense. And I used to make this joke a lot, and then it turns out it may not be so much of a joke. So when I was working in sort of math biology, so I was initially doing a lot of revisions on calculus courses for biology majors, and as I was doing this work, I had a lot of head start, I guess you could say, having had a multidisciplinary curriculum throughout my undergraduate and graduate studies. But I noticed that, especially in working also with faculty who were trying to implement change, that where are the places where we advance in that work? Where are the places we grow? If we say we want to be interdisciplinary, how do we really become interdisciplinary? And what are the ways in which our disciplines have co-evolved together? We talk a lot about, well, it's not just what math can do for biology, but what biology can do for mathematics, right? And I think that's the heart of mutualistic bipartite systems. And so as I was entering into this Summit P collaboration, which incidentally is also funded by NSF IUS under their sort of broader frameworks for mathematics revisions. It was an 11 institution grant, so $3 million grant across 11 institutions, again, each of which had a different partner. And while I was still working on calculus reform, though this time in conjunction primarily with a marine biology partner, at the back of my head, I wanted to say, I want to make this more than just what's happening at my institution. How do I capture this in a way that can be more broadly disseminated, thought of, conceptualized, et cetera. So the specific subaward that was for Unity College was called CORAL. Every great grant needs a good acronym. CORAL Reese and Associated Labs. We also had a new wet lab that was for CORAL studies, so that fit quite nicely. Every single one of these institutions had a co-PI that was out of mathematics. So my co-PI was Dr. Perry, who was in marine biology. I also had a co-PI who was in writing, Dr. Stephanie Wade. We also hired as part of this project, because I think is instrumental, an undergraduate student who had been in mathematics classes and biology classes and had that perspective, but also made a wonderful research assistant as well. Unity College, some similarities to COA. I don't know how much you've heard about COA. We have like more than twice as many students as COA. when I started there, we had like 550. Now we're in the 800-ish area. All environmental majors one way or another, and a sustainability science mission. You're gonna debate over my America's Environmental College. Yeah. Sorry, a little rivalry there. So our goal in this particular project was to develop more connections between calculus and marine biology. So marine biology had just started requiring calculus as part of its major revisions. And also we wanted to align our writing across all of these as well. The first semester, we focused on some of the planning. We hired our research assistant and started setting up the CORAL lab for some work we might want to do. In the spring, the marine biologist, Dr. Perry, sat in on my Calculus 1 course the whole semester. God bless her. And in the summer, we talked a lot about curriculum alignment, some of the things that we were noticing were in common across. And in the fall, I sat in on Dr. Perry's marine biology class, which was an introduction to the major in a lot of ways. It was a first semester sophomore class. And in the spring, Dr. Perry sat in on my Calculus 2 class. And then I moved to Bates, unfortunately, so we weren't able to continue it beyond that. But the work that I'm going to talk about for the rest of this focuses primarily on this fall 2017 when I sat in on marine. And first I'll notice, wow, this really hit me, this engagement of the experiential. The first lab that we had, we all went out in the field, and everybody was so excited to be there. I was like, wow, nobody's ever that excited for the first lab of calculus, let me tell you, right? I mean, it was so palpable. There's also like something that again, mathematicians don't get experience a lot of, and that's just like driving with a van full of students out to a field site, right? Like, we miss out on a lot of that conversation and mentoring and interesting other kinds of things. However, I did not dress for the occasion. I was freezing. I had to borrow like 3 layers and an oversized lab coat, and everybody thought it was hilarious and took pictures of me. And I am really a dry lab person. Okay, so what was my role in sitting in on this class? I mean, partly it was to observe, try to make some notes, but I saw myself in some sense, not really a co-teacher, but more like a math coach. So trying to just sort of be an advisor as needed for, hey, is this good? Is this wording good? Which, you know, sort of more quantitative question should appear on this test kind of thing. And I kind of helped work through a lot of the lab assignments and exams with that instructor. But in addition, I just sort of sat in on the class and took notes. So this is where the complex adaptive systems comes in, okay? So if I treat biology or even a subdiscipline of biology and mathematics, so marine biology and calculus, as co-evolving disciplines, right? So this is what, you know, evolution of co-evolving things might look like over time. So what would that look like? I'd have to create like a data set that looked at sort of topics in marine biology and topics in mathematics and then do some kind of analysis between. And I felt like this was, you know, this idea had been percolating in my head for a long time. And when I started thinking about how can I make this work that I'm doing in this class in these specific modules, how can I make that live beyond that particular class? Like this is it. I'm gonna test this theory that I had that I think that this could be treated or viewed in this way. And so I kept a log of you know, the marine biology topics, the math topics, and then a broader thing, the context under which it occurred, just in case I had any additional questions. Every single lecture throughout the entire semester. And then we used traditional R packages that are usually used in ecological network analysis to delve into the data. And this is what we ended up with. So on the left, you have all of the math topics. And these weren't necessarily words that the instructor used. This was my categorization of what she was saying using my language. And this was her language. This is the words she was actually using or the topics in marine biology that they were related to. And what you can see a little bit is the sort of thick bars, and so the thicker the bar, the more often that's used. So here you can see log. This is also log scale and other kinds of scaling. Max, min, also used quite frequently. So that was max, min, optimization. In terms of, and you can sort of already notice some patterns or some things that jump out. The other thing we do in network analysis, we might look at a distribution of connections. And so this particular histogram is across all of the math topics in the course. How many are referenced only once? How many come up multiple times? So as you can guess, these are the log scaling, max, min. a vast majority are used only once. And I think that this is, while not unsurprising, this is actually totally expected if you're working in a mutualistic bipartite coevolving system. This is called a truncated power law distribution. You have a high number of specialists and low numbers of generalists. From an educational perspective, this, I think, gives us a little pause. Most of the math things that we're talking about, we use once. And we're using a lot of them once. I wonder why it's so hard sometimes to have nice coherent storylines about quantitative uses in the biology curriculum. So I think already we're kind of hitting some really interesting take homes. So these are the top two most referenced areas. Under what marine context were they occurring? Max, min, and optimization, physiological performance curves, trying to think about how you're best suited for life in the ocean. Oceanography, broadly speaking, physical oceanography, solar lunar orbits, trenches, and Reynolds numbers, et cetera. Also a little bit marine protected areas, I guess, is the sort of third area. So if it's not physiology and life history and physiological performance, then we're talking about physical oceanography and then maybe one class on marine protected areas. Scale and scaling, that came up in pH, sediment analysis, transects, topography, marine mammals, all sorts of other things as well. And then you had a few topics that were kind of in the mid-range number of mentions, models, independent and dependent variables, et cetera. Okay. So this data set is slightly biased in the sense that I'm not, I'm only recording marine items when a math reference has occurred. So this is also subject to the same bias you would see in field observation studies of plant pollinator, because they usually set up by a plant and see who visits it, so it's kind of similar. some of the same sort of multiple times, only one reference, very few had used over and over again connected to mathematics. So what we're saying here is that the math references themselves are also spread over multiple marine topics. Very few marine topics have multiple math references associated with them. What are those mathy marine topics? So most mathy marine topic in this class was tides, again, the physical oceanography, vectors, ellipses, scaling, periods, variances, means, all sorts of things. And then second most, salinity, form function, currents. As expected, again, in mutualistic networks, there's an asymmetry in topic connections. The most mathy marine topic is not necessarily using the same math as the most commonly referenced math topic. That makes it even more confusing from a pedagogical perspective. There was a little bit of overlap. Form and function was sort of the most mathy, as well as most used optimization, which was the most referenced math. And so I had a lot of questions coming out of it, a lot of emergent questions that come out when you analyze a data set without trying to, you know, not have too many preconceived notions about what you'll find. And, you know, how does this affect student learning of mathematical and quantitative topics? How might it be, or even biology topics that are heavily quantitative dependent? How could we use this perspective to inform interdisciplinary module development? So one of the other things I looked at was a sort of interaction matrix here. This is a little less telling, but when you sort it, so again, ecological networks have this sense of modularity, clustering, and you look at sort of how connected is. The upper left quadrant's pretty sparse, but this box actually strikes me as a lot of highly related math and biology topics don't really appear elsewhere, and could be really good fodder for an educational module that's interdisciplinary. So in this particular context, it was something with independent, dependent variables, percentage, direct inverse variation, something to do with depth and salinity and estuaries. So it feels like we could do a small modeling module here that appeared possibly in a math class, possibly in the biology class, that related those two things together. And it might be a good use of overlap. The other thing I noticed, I tried not to comment on it earlier, but one of the things that I found most interesting was where, if I had observed other marine biology, introduction to marine biology classes, I'm sure I would have observed different patterns of connections. And for this particular instance, and where the instructor and I are working together, what are the places that are most mathy for this class? Are there any patterns that I'm noticing? And it seemed like, actually, a great many of these could be clustered into two areas: physical oceanography and evolution, form, and function. And it's no accident, I think, that for the physical oceanography unit, an external YouTube video was sourced for a lot of the in-class instruction time. So what she's doing is she's using vetted quality curricular materials in the classroom to help her achieve quantitative outcomes in language and discussion. The second place, this evolution, form, and function, is actually reflective of that faculty member's own research area, which was in systematics and in morphology. So the other place where she was willing to be more quantitative was in a place very closely related to her own identity, subdisciplinary training, etc. So I think these two things may be really important in how we move towards other disciplines: high quality in construction, and also trying to think about where our own grounding is and moving forward in those places. And in terms of easy to use quality materials and curricular materials, you know, shout out to Complexity Explorer too, right? Because, you know, I've used this in my teaching when I taught an Introduction to Systems Thinking course, and I used some of the videos right from the website, because I was like, oh, she's doing a great job, better than my on-screen cast-o-matic. I also think another interesting take-home is how we ask students to engage in a broad variety of quantitative tasks in the classroom without even maybe noticing it or realizing it. And I think there is merit to thinking about the coevolution of these disciplines and what it can teach us about our teaching, about interdisciplinarity, about thinking about it as a coevolving mutualistic network. Okay, so I just want to acknowledge some of the folks part of this project, Cubes, NIMBIOS's support. I also want to thank my student, Sarah Neitzel, for she was a research student. She did all, I said, hey, I want to treat this as a co-evolving network, and you're going to use this analysis. And she was like, oh, that's so cool. So not many, you know, students, undergraduate students you can bring along for that ride, but she was right in there with me. And so I just have to absolutely acknowledge her. And thank you again for the invitation to talk. I wanted to leave time for questions. Sure.
I know in one of the documentaries, the last one was talking about mechanisms and society. So, kind of like keeping the spirit of that, I guess, like what do you feel like are the connection of ways to apply the unified or the idea of